Good morning, PJ here. It is Sunday, January 28, 2024. I'm here in my office before our worship service. I'm going to be reading the gospel reading and preaching the sermon today. The gospel reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent, and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him, and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread through the surrounding regions of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord. On Tuesday, we had 9 individuals who gathered in the conference room for our Bible study, and the conversation was very lively. In fact, it was so lively, we did not even get to page 2 of the study, which may or may have not disappointed some, because that is story time. Some of the words that were prominent in our dialogue were disruption, authority, and change. I am hoping to touch on those words as the sermon develops. This passage also left us with more questions than I was able to provide answers for, so I went digging. Let's dive right in. And may I answer some of those questions while focusing on the key 3 words. Our story today began by Mark sharing with us that Jesus and the 4 fishermen that he had just called went up to Capernaum. Mark shares with us that it is Sabbath, thus they went to the synagogue. As they entered the synagogue, Jesus begins to speak and people are amazed. They truly were astounded at what they were witnessing. In one corner, there is Jesus. In the other corner, there are the scribes. And the scriptures tells us that Jesus taught with much more authority than the scribes. There is one of those 3 words, authority. Here is a taste of some of the questions that came out of the study that began the digging for today's sermon. What was the purpose of the scribes? What does it truly mean to have authority? I think understanding these 2 questions may be a great foundation that will give us a solid foundation and understanding of what it is that is about to take place. It might help us if we realize that Mark might have a slightly different take on authority than us. For Mark, authority could be better described as an acquired honor. The honor that he speaks of is gained through social interaction. Thus, at the synagogue, we're connecting with Jesus in a way that they had not connected with the scribes. With us hearing the word scribe once again, I imagine that you might have the same questions about the scribes. Who were they and what was their purpose? One of the most well-known scribes was Ezra. A great homework assignment could be for you to connect with that book in the Old Testament. He was a teacher that was well-versed in the law of Moses. The scribes in general took their job of preserving scripture very seriously. They would spend their days copying and recopying the Bible meticulously. They even took the time to count every letter and every space to ensure that each copy that was made was made correctly. We can give thanks to the Jewish scribes for preserving the portion of the Bible that we know as the Old Testament. However, at times they also added many man-made traditions to what God had said, and their proficiency in spelling out the letter of the law, they ignored the spirit of the law that was behind it. The regulations and traditions that the scribes added to the law became more important than the law itself. And as you can imagine, this led to many confrontations between Jesus, the Pharisees, and the scribes. Outside of copying, much of the scribes' duties were teaching in the synagogue. They would do an exposition of the law and take the words of the prophet and try to share those words through a lens that would make an impact at the present moment. Those who were gathered that day believed that Jesus' interpretation was more relevant. Jesus was not bringing a new teaching to them. What he was doing was sharing with them how to take the teaching at hand and make a difference in their lives and the community that they lived in. This is another component of Jesus' authority, though. He had the authority to perform an exorcism. The exorcism at the synagogue was definitely an interruption, another word that was lifted up out of our study. As I dove into some of the early teachings of the church, many individuals believed that the demons that had taken over the man's body was representing the scribes' opinion of Jesus. Now, I don't want to jump too far ahead in Mark, but in Mark 3, which we'll be reading on June 9th, we see that the scribes accused Jesus of being able to cast out demons because Satan had control of him. Now, Mark then takes it a step further, and we may not even recognize it. What he does is separates Jesus from the scribes. This is done because Mark leans into the fact that the scribes' teachings could be considered demonic because their teachings did not liberate people. Instead, their teachings oppressed and enslaved people. So when I was contemplating this teaching and thought, I was taken back to our study on Tuesday. We spent a considerable amount of time on the disruption and the verbal exchange that occurred. The man with the demonic spirit asked Jesus the following question: "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." We speculated about the reasons that the unclean spirits knew who he was and that those in the attendance did not recognize him. One of the answers that sparked my interest was a comment made by a Bible study participant that Jesus was a known enemy. That could be a reason. And exploring that line of thought, I found many pointing to the fact that demons are spiritual beings, and thus they recognized a spiritual being in Jesus. Human beings were seeing Jesus as purely a human being. The exchange did not last long. Jesus commands the demonic to be silent, and then he cast out the demon. And Jesus does not engage in a power struggle. Jesus simply rebuked the spirit, put an end to the chaotic disruption. I'm not a first century scholar. Thus, I have to rely on those who are more knowledgeable than I. And this week, I had learned that in the culture that Jesus lived, that one doing the naming had more authority than the one being named. And that was a moment for me. And I had to step back and pause and reflect on that for a few minutes. Jesus silenced the demons because he did not want them naming him and claiming authority. When the demons left him, They came out crying in a loud voice, and it left the man convulsing on the ground. The man was changed because of his exchange with Jesus. And before I dive into that change, I do want to emphasize that this story is revealing the dominion of God has come near. We can see and sense that God's enemies are beginning to be defeated, and that Satan's rule over the world is about to end. Change is very hard. However, I think in this text that we can be challenged to make a change that many of us struggle to make. I'm not sure about you, but for me, I struggle to have the courage, at times, to name the demons that possess us as a community, a nation, and as a human race. Why am I afraid to name demons? Well, at times, if I name them, it will make me unpopular and individuals may tune me out. Then on the other hand, I am reminded that if we do not stand up to the demons like Jesus, the demons will control and destroy us. Maybe as I am sharing these thoughts, there are demons that come to your mind. One that I read and heard a lot this past week from the generation younger than I was out of control capitalism. Whatever demon or evil that comes to your mind, here is the good news. Evil is challenged and destroyed by the kingdom of God. God intends that everyone should be freed by the evil that imprisons them. I think that if we name the demon, pray that the demon can be ousted, and then follow through with action, that change can happen. In a better world, it's actually possible. As I wrap up this sermon, let me go back to where it all began. Jesus in Capernaum. Jesus begins his ministry by entering into a sacred space, the Sabbath. He is also entering into a sacred place, the synagogue. It's easy to skip over these two facts and jump straight to the exorcism because I do believe that is the centerpiece of this text. However, the space and place might be just the things that makes the healing significant. I want you to place yourself in a synagogue just for a few seconds. Think about what you might be feeling as you witness the power and the authority of Jesus. There would be some in the space that was not happy. They came there to be refreshed, and they experienced a disruption. How about us today? Maybe this story can be a reminder that when Christ shows up in our holy places and spaces, that some of us might not be entirely excited about the results. This morning, I want to challenge you to see if the God that you know provokes you to awe. And friends, let us release our fear and have the courage to expose the evil that causes chaos and frightens us. Amen.